Hey, Scott, I need you to pick up a few things for the staff Christmas party if you get a chance. Thanks.
Scott, don't forget we got the Christmas Eve planning that's coming up. It should be in about 45 minutes.
Hey, Scott, your mom's at the airport. She needs you to pick her up.
LAX.
Wait, hold on, guys. I found Jesus.
It's about time.
Said the night wind to the little lamb. Do you see what I see? Sky, little lamb, do you see what I see?
A star.
As you can see, we take things super serious around here. But really, just kind of a snapshot of, I know, probably your life now, really life in general at times. We've got so many plates spinning, so many things that we have to try to accomplish that it can really take the joy away from Christmas, can it? 'Tis the season to be jolly. Does some of you feel like going to that one, right? And you know, for some of us, it happens so fast that by the time it's over, we're like, oh, okay, now we got to take off, put everything back away, put everything in the boxes, and it's like a deep breath instead of really a celebration for what it should have been all about. And that's really what I hope to be able to start in this series today, is to get our minds where they need to be, to really focus on the reason for the season. Because the reality of the season often is more stress. The cares of life being amplified. And the reality with stress, I think for some of us, we feel like stress is okay, that it helps us to get things done. Hey, you know, it's just a natural part of life. I got a lot of things going on, Pastor. You have no idea. Let me just give you a quick overview of stress when it comes to the biblical principle of stress. It says to not be stressed. It says to be anxious for nothing. We understand through Scripture, it tells us even that stress is unnatural. It's not a natural wiring that God has wired us for and wants us to enjoy. You may be familiar when Jesus is preaching to his disciples, he shares the fact that the birds of the air and the lilies of the field, they're not anxious. They're not stressing out about what things are going to be and where they're going to come from. They just exist under the Heavenly Father's care. And because it's unnatural, it becomes unhealthy, doesn't it? I mean, I just listed a few things about the effects of stress to the human body. Things like rapid heartbeat, headaches, stiff neck, tight shoulders, backache, rapid breathing, sweaty palms, upset stomach, nausea, diarrhea, ulcers. Sounds like fun, right? Sounds like one of those ads that we see. We understand that it's not healthy. And I even think about in the context of things that aren't healthy and the side effects that they have because they're not natural. How many of you guys know that one of the things that's rampant in our athletic department this season, the last 10, 20 years, is PEDs, right? Performance-enhancing drugs. And it reminds me of this because maybe for a little while we think it's helpful, but in the long term, it's not helpful. It's something that's very unhealthy. Even PEDs, you see, whether it's a quick recovery or building muscle mass and helping them to achieve certain things, the long-term effects are very, very bad. You may have heard years ago, there was even a wrestler who was a Christian man who ended up taking his own life and took the life of his whole family because of the steroid rage that he was in. We see the side effects even in health, that some of these people are dying of young age because of the effects of steroids and PEDs. Well, it's not PEDs, but at the same time, stress sometimes can be underestimated in our lives, like it's really not that big of a deal. But it really is. We need to manage it, and God has called us to be able to have a peace that surpasses even human understanding and in all kinds of situations. Not only the physical effects, also the effects in mood, right? Can you guys identify with getting a little more frustrated when you're stressed? You're a lot quicker to get angry and to blow up at someone. I got to confess, especially the last couple of days, it's just God's sense of humor have been pretty stressful for me. I just had a lot of stuff going on, trying to get a lot of things done. And it's like, man, I'm not really feeling peace. And God's like, oh, well, you're preaching on it this Sunday, so you better get it in control, right? But I can identify with it personally that a lot of times we're trying to accomplish all these different things and it becomes stressful. And here's the second confession. I had an occasion this week on Friday, actually, to have a conversation over the phone with one of our contractors. And all I'm going to say is it definitely wasn't spiritual. I was definitely in the flesh because I was stressed out. I was angry, and I wasn't a real great example. And, you know, that's not something I want to do, nor something that you want to do. Not only that, you send a text message when you're stressed. Probably not a good idea, right? All of these different things that we have experienced on a personal level, the cause being not having the peace that God wants us to have. Here's one that I found really interesting. Do you realize that when you're anxious or stressed that you're literally not as productive, you're more unproductive than when you do have everything under control and you're peaceful? Because for me, I always kind of feel like, okay, well, you know, I'm carrying this stress. It's a tough time. I got a lot of stuff going on, but I got to get it done, right? The reality is that when you're carrying this stress and you're in this place, you're actually getting less things done because you're carrying so much stress. And so with all that being said, what I want to be able to do is to explore the scriptures to be able to say, God, where can we find this missing peace, P-E-A-C-E, that we are looking for and that you have promised? So I'm going to ask you guys in your Bibles to turn to a story you may be familiar with. It's found in Luke's Gospel, chapter 10, Luke 10, starting in verse 38. How many of you guys have ever heard the story of Mary and Martha? Say, I've heard that one before, Pastor. You know, in my study time this week, just something that I came across, I was like, wow, that is crazy how fitting it is to this message of trying to get so many things done and really not focusing in on what the main purpose really should be about the season. It starts out in verse 38 of Luke 10 this way, and it says, "Now as they went on their way, Jesus entered a village, and a woman named Martha welcomed him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to his teaching. But Martha was distracted with much serving, and she went up to him and said, 'Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Tell her then to help me.' But the Lord answered her, 'Martha, Martha, you are anxious and troubled about many things, but one thing is necessary. Mary has chosen the good portion, which will not be taken away from her.'" You know, I think we read this story, and at least for me, immediately I go to the image of someone who's not really doing their part at the family gathering. Anybody have these people, relatives, that kind of just sit there? They want to watch the football game, and the dishes need to be cleaned up, right? I have four of them. My oldest son, my second oldest son, my daughter, and my other son. I mean, this is not the picture. This is not really what Mary is going to Jesus saying, hey, she's not doing her part. What's going on here, and I think it's translated in the NIV really well, when it actually says she was troubled at so much preparation that she really was losing what Jesus wanted her to see. And obviously we have hindsight, as we do when we study the scriptures, but isn't it crazy to think that Jesus is entering into their house and she's busy doing all of this stuff to prepare for the party? And Mary takes this occasion, this opportunity, to truly sit at the feet of her Lord and to be able to learn from Him and to be able to love on Him. I mean, I try to put it in my own kind of reference as far as it being something in the modern time. It would be to me like if Jesus walked into our church, and many of us here serve at church. And can you imagine if you were getting the coffee together and you were a greeter, you were one of the ushers, and all of a sudden Jesus walked in and you were just like, oh, cool, Jesus is here, and you just kept doing your thing. How many of you know you guys would stop dead in your tracks, right? It'd be like, I could care less right now about ushering. Jesus is in the house, right? Can you imagine if Jesus came up here and preached? How many of you guys would like that a lot better? Amen? Me too. I mean, we would all understand what the amazing opportunity that we had. And that's what's going on here in this story. But tying it to what we're talking about today is we're talking about God becoming a human being, living amongst us, humbling Himself, putting on a man suit, if you will, to be one of us so that He could live amongst us and die for us. And yet we can get so caught up in all the preparations and hanging the lights and putting the tree up and wrapping the gifts and doing all of those things that we miss what it's all about. The reason for the season is Jesus. It's not about who has the coolest house. It's not about getting first prize on the lighting competition in your neighborhood. All those things are great frills, and I don't bag on any of them. By the way, I don't have any lights up yet, so sorry, I'm one of those guys. But the reality is those should be things on the outside, not the center of what Christmas is all about. And sometimes we can become just like Mary and get so caught up in everything else that we forget about what it's all about. You see, Jesus said that He came to be our peace, our peace. As I often do when I have a sermon to preach and I'm thinking about one word that really summarizes it, I like to look at that word in the dictionary to kind of get a better context of what it means. So I did that with the word peace. And let me read to you the definition in Webster's Dictionary of peace. It says this: peace is the absence of irritation, frustration, disturbance, anxiety, or obsession. In peace, you have no conflict, chaos, or crises. Here's my pushback. That sounds like Fantasy Island there to me. I mean, you got to be kidding me. I mean, I even read in the scripture, what did Jesus tell His disciples? In this world, you will have tribulation. You will have chaos. You will have conflict. And you will have crises. We've all lived enough life to know that that is going to happen. So how do I find peace in the midst of all of those things? You see, this is Webster's definition. This isn't God's definition. Because God's definition is found in Jesus Christ. And it's found only in Him. I read this and I want to give it to you because it was something that really spoke to me. The saying that says true peace is not the absence of conflict, chaos, or crises, but it is in the presence of Christ. To be in His presence, we find that peace that surpasses all understanding. In His presence, we can hit the ground running even in a busy day and be able to find a peace amongst a busy, crazy schedule. It's found only in Him. Many of us have sat through Christmas series, Christmas sermons, and understand often the word peace is surrounded in the Christmas story, isn't it? First of all, we read about it. Let me read it to you in Isaiah 9 and 6. This prophecy given even before Jesus was born says this, Isaiah 9, 6, for to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon His shoulder, and His name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and what? Prince of Peace. He is the Prince of Peace. And then we get into the Christmas story itself, which many of us have read, maybe even on Christmas morning to our families, or we hear on Christmas Eve services we attend. Luke chapter 2 tells us of this occasion, starting in verse 8, Luke 2, 8. In that same region, there were shepherds out in the field keeping watch over their flock by night. And the angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was an angel and a multitude of heavenly hosts praising God and saying, "Glory to the God in the highest, and on earth peace amongst those whom he has pleased." So we see this word peace, but just like I was sharing, looking for my granddaughter's locket, many times it's elusive. Many times we kind of know the concept. It's like, okay, that's great. Jesus is the Prince of Peace. Awesome, Pastor. What does that mean? Okay, in the story, the angels, peace amongst men. It's like, but why am I not experiencing it personally? What I want to be able to do for the next few moments is to help you to understand how you can truly find peace. If that peace is missing in your life today, you really need to look at two things. And the first one I'm going to start out on is, have you truly found peace with God? You know, the Bible declares that we are enemies of God. And I know that sounds kind of harsh, but that is the reality. Because of our sin nature, it says that we've been separated from God and we are now his enemies. We are doing things that oppose him naturally in our sinful nature, you see. I mean, we see this in the Bible, don't we? Old Testament, you get a guy by the name of Jacob. You remember Jacob? Known as the deceiver, who was kind of doing things his way and trying to manipulate the situation and deceiving everybody. Kind of an interesting name to me, the deceiver. How many of you guys never use the name deceiver? Anybody? He's such a deceiver, brother. I like to use the word weasel. Can we go with that? He's just a weasel, right? I mean, this guy was a weasel. And he comes to a point in his life where it says he wrestles with God. That God confronts him with the truth of who he is, of the things that need to change in his life. And there's this wrestling match that takes place. And it says at the end, as God defeats him, he changes his name to the word Israel. You know what the word Israel means? Governed by God. That he literally surrendered at that moment and says, "God, you're the leader of my team right now. Hey, you're governing me. I need your direction. Where do I go from here?" And then we fast forward to the New Testament. Ever hear of a guy by the name of Saul of Tarsus, who became Paul the Apostle? Very similar, right? He had almost a fight with God. It literally tells us that when Jesus confronted him, he said, "It is very difficult for you to continue to kick against the goads." Goads, you guys know what goads are, right? A goad, we obviously aren't. I was being facetious. It was kind of like a long prod, like a long stick that was used as kind of a guiding an animal. You kind of poke them in the rear end, if you will. Hey, come on, go this way. And it says he's kicking against the goads of the truth of who God is. He's persecuting God's church. And he comes to a point where he surrenders his life to Jesus Christ. And we know the rest of the story. He writes almost half of the New Testament. I mean, this guy was radically changed by God. But one of my favorites, and a little bit more contemporary, is found in the movie Forrest Gump. You know the great theologian Forrest. Anybody watched this movie before? Anybody familiar with the character by the name of Lieutenant Dan? Interesting character to me. Somebody I believe who was also in this wrestling match with God, at least in the character in the movie. Like, it was like he kind of found his identity. He said that it was my destiny to die on the field because my father and his father before him and his father before him, this is the way he felt he was going to have value in this life, is to be a soldier who served faithfully but yet died to be able to give the ultimate sacrifice. And you see what ends up happening. He ends up losing his legs. They're amputated. And he has this major crisis, this major struggle in who he is. And it's just like he begins to just go to the bottle. He begins to try to self-medicate. He has this whole journey. And then all of a sudden, he finds himself with Forrest again out on a shrimping boat, on the Bubba Shrimp boat. You guys remember the scene? And now all of a sudden, there's a great storm that's getting ready to come in. And then he kind of gets up on the, you know, kind of the little post that goes straight up, whatever they call that, mast or something. I'm not like, obviously, a ship guy. But whatever that tall thing is, he's up there. And you guys remember the crow's nest? And he's just like the winds, and he's just like, bring it on, right? It's you and me, God. And he's just like, it's like he's in this fight. And then all of a sudden, the storm passes. And then you see this scene of Lieutenant Dan doing a backstroke in the still water. And I remember Forrest Gump at the time. He looks out and he sees this scene and he says, I think he found his peace with God. You like that? It was good, wasn't it? I mean, you guys got to encourage me. I was in the mirror trying to do that all morning. I was like the mannerisms. I'm just kidding, sort of. But we see that this is a common struggle, not just to Jacob, not just to Paul the apostle, not even just to Lieutenant Dan, but it's human nature. Because see, we are at enmity with God. We are opposed to the things of God because of our sinful nature. And yet Jesus Christ, the one that we are celebrating this season, came to this earth to be able to reconcile us, to give us peace with God. He's brought us back into the right relationship with God. That's why we should be celebrating during Christmas and thinking more about Jesus than we are about what gifts are under the tree. Thinking more about Jesus than we are about what wrapping paper we're going to use this year. And do we have enough of the, what's that fluffy stuff they throw in those bags now? All right, the tissue paper. I can't keep up with all these things. Too much stuff for me. But in all seriousness, we understand that we can get so off track. But the reality and the first question I have for you today is, have you found peace with God? Have you asked Jesus Christ to become your Lord and your Savior? Have you asked him, confessing that you are a sinner, that you've made mistakes in this life, that you know that are opposed to him and who he has made you? And you've asked for his forgiveness and for his blood to be able to cleanse you so that you can enter into heaven and into his presence for all of eternity. That's where it all starts. It's got to start in a personal relationship with him. But the reality is it doesn't just stop there, because we're in this continual washing cycle, if you will. This merry-go-round of life that can seem to just take the peace right away from us. And so the Bible talks to us about the peace of God as well. Not just peace with God. That, hey, okay, I've asked for forgiveness. You know, I've had that conversation with God. We're good. But how about your everyday life? How about the life that you're living? How about the examples that I even shared with you about stressing out this week and saying something I probably shouldn't have to a contractor who's working for the church? Throwing a text out there, here or there, an email from here that shouldn't be sent out because you're frustrated and annoyed and you're not finding that peace. You see, it tells us, I want to focus on two things as we close about the peace of God. It tells us, first of all, in Colossians 3:15, speaking of the peace of God, it says, let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful. To be the ruler, the Greek word literally is the same word we get the word umpire from. I don't know about you, but I've had a few run-ins with the umpire. Anybody else? Man, these authority figures sometimes, right? It's because of our rebellious nature. But it's no different when it comes to Christ leading us and guiding us and trying to put us in the right place and say, go this direction. And yet we often rebel against that and we're like, I don't know why I'm not experiencing peace. Or are you allowing God to call the shots in your life? Do you just call him Lord, or is he truly the Lord of the way you live this life? God, you said it. I believe it. That settles it. Tell me where to go, God. Help me out with this decision, God. What do I need to do next, God? He wants to lead and to guide our life, but we've got to allow it to take place. Not only does he want to guide us, he wants to guard us. A scripture many of you are familiar with in Philippians chapter 4, right? One that we often pray, one that often when we visit people who are going through a difficult time, we pray, and I actually even pray this out loud, but let me read it to you starting in verse 4. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, Let your requests be known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and guard your mind. You see, to me, it's kind of a natural progression. You've got to allow God to lead you, to guide you in whatever direction that is. But even in that journey, there's going to come times where you're unsettled and I don't know, I don't have all the answers. I'm not sure how this is going to work out. I didn't see it going this way. And you've got to cry out to God and say, God, I need that peace that surpasses all understanding. Because it, from my vantage point right now, I'm getting stressed. I'm losing that peace. I don't know how this is going to work out. And he says that he will literally guard our hearts and keep that peace within us. But we've got to cry out to him. I go back to the little statement I made that the true peace that we can experience is found in the presence of Jesus Christ. Where are you at today in your relationship with Jesus? Are you fostering the relationship? Are you growing in that personal relationship you have with him? You know, one of the things for me that was really kind of revolutionary in my journey with Jesus was this. You know, coming to church and hearing like a broken record, read your Bible more, you need to pray more, and you know, you got to do more hours this, and you got to fellowship, and there's all these things. And I almost began to look at them as a checklist, right? Okay, well, I read my Bible today, check. I prayed for a little while, check. And you start feeling good, but you see, all of these things are relational. They can become just ritualistic practices in our life if we're not careful, if we don't really understand what they're there for. Think about even the Bible and prayer. God talking to you and wanting to hear your voice back in return. I mean, how relational can it get? What do they say the number one thing in any relationship is? Communication. Are you communicating with God? Are you allowing him to communicate back to you and to give you that guidance that he desires to give you? I mean, when we look at it that way, I mean, reading the Bible should be something that's exciting, not like, oh man, I don't really have a lot of time. I'm not a good reader. It's like, dude, God wants to talk to you, bro. I mean, like, seriously, how much better does it get than that? It's just like I said, hey, if Jesus walked in, how many of us would be flipping out going, oh my, this is the best Sunday ever, bro. But yet, he's given us this book where he says, literally, my voice is there for you to listen to. We need to see it for what it is. And even in prayer. I remember prayer. And, you know, it's one of those things where it's always been like, I'm not a good prayer, you know. The very first time I had to pray, we did a thing called Supper 6. And I was freaking out because the guy who hosted, the man of the house, was supposed to pray. Man, I am freaking out. Like, I don't pray in front of people. I wrote it all out, said it. If you know, that's not good. You know, it's like, and you begin to overcomplicate something that's just talking to God, whether it's out loud or whether it's just in your head. Anybody else freak out on that scripture when you first came across it, when it said, pray without ceasing? Like, God, I got other stuff I got to do. I can't. You want me just to like pray all day long? I mean, you know, the wife's probably not going to be happy because I'm not going to be bringing home a check anymore. I'd just be praying. You know, I got kids to raise. But here's what I understand about that verse: is God just wants to be in continual communication with us. It's just some of those conversations. Are you aware of the presence of God? Are you even talking to him now? Or you ask him, God, help me today. God, help me with this situation. God, I'm getting ready to walk in a meeting. I need to be in your spirit. God, I got a conversation coming up that I know is going to be difficult. Man, fill me with your peace. Just having that constant prayer language with God to be able to communicate to him. You know, one of the privileges I have today to end my time is to lead you through communion. And when I think about communion, I think it's another relational thing, isn't it? Again, even in Christian church, where we can make it so ritualistic and religious instead of relational. But what did Jesus tell his followers? And then what did Paul say in Corinthians? He said, as often as you do this in remembrance of Jesus. You know what the word remember is? It's to return it to your mind. To remember. Are you doing a rewind when you do communion, thinking about what Jesus has done in your life? The love that he showed you, the grace that he's bestowed upon you, the goodness of who he is, the love that he has for all of humanity? Or do we just kind of... You know, it just can become that. I mean, can we just be honest in the house of God? I want to be someone who truly experiences God, don't you? I want to quit reading about peace and truly have peace. I want to quit reading about joy and really have joy. I want to have these things that God has promised to me. But yet sometimes they're just some little word up there in my head that we say around each other as Christians. How you doing, brother? Blessed. I mean, what God has given to us to celebrate in the Christmas season is everything. It's the answer to this life. To be able to have those things because we understand that we're at peace with God. That we've been forgiven, that we don't have to beat ourselves up anymore for our past mistakes or even the ones that we're going to do in the future. To be able to say, Jesus has paid for that. He loves me so much, he wants to spend all of eternity with me. I pray today that you would truly answer two questions. Number one, do you have peace with God? If not, I pray that you reach that moment maybe that Lieutenant Dan reached. That even in the stillness of your own mind and heart, that you would cry out to God today and say, God, forgive me of my sins. Man, I've made a mess of these things. But I want to know this peace. I want to receive your forgiveness today. God, I want you to be on the throne of my heart. I want you to lead my life. God, I surrender to you. Second of all, if you've already made that decision, I ask you to be honest during this moment of communion with God to really answer the question, are you experiencing his peace? Do you have the peace of God that is guiding you and guarding you? And if not, would you just admit that to him? He just wants to hear your voice. He just wants you to say, God, you know what's going on, man. I've been running from you. I've been doing things my own way. But God, today, I want that peace. Jesus, I want you to fill me today with you. And he, as he always is, will be so faithful to be able to pour that into your life. But he's just waiting for you to ask.